And this is our cat, Lily. This is Cinder. We've got the truck.
We've got the trailer.
And we're ready for our RV travel quest.
Hi, I'm Rob.
I'm Sherry.
And today is a new adventure. We are going to the Deschutes Brewery.
Yep.
In Bend, Oregon. Never been to a brewery before. Have you ever been to one before?
No, I haven't. Huh.
So, they said we can take cameras. We're going to take the gimbal in, we're going to take the 360 in, see what we can capture, and bring you along. So come join us with Deschutes Brewery. All right, guys, talk to you later. Bye.
Bye.
Hi, guys, we're here at the Deschutes Brewery, and we're about to go in. It's a beautiful building, and let me have it look up a little bit. And we're about to enter, so I hope you enjoy the show. Here we go.
How does this work?
So as part of the tour, we get 4 samples of beer, so we have quite a list to choose from. And we can do part of it now or part of it at the end of the tour.
Sweet. Well, maybe we should start with 2 now and 2 later.
We need to watch our time, so.
Yeah, so we got 15 minutes that we can do a taste test. So I'm going to shut this off for a minute because we're going to make some choices. What are you getting?
I'm getting the Mirror Pond Pale Ale.
Mirror Pond.
Sweet.
Cheers.
All right, thank you.
Later.
This one's what?
This one is a little bit blonder. Yours is much darker.
Yeah.
All right. Take a little lens here. We'll go to our table, and we're going to try these out. I like how your lip smacking. See, I like that a lot better. But that's just me.
That's the Mirror Pond Pale Ale.
They're nice.
Good beer too. Harpoon's top 10, I believe.
Yeah.
So they're doing it right too.
still not really sure when people say West Coast IPAs when they're from the East Coast, but, you know, that's just me.
Well, it's because they're using a West Coast hop.
Yeah, that's what they say. I've tried a few of them, and some of them, they're getting there. But I don't want them to be the same. I mean, I really don't. If I want a West Coast IPA, I live on the West Coast.
Right.
If I go to the East Coast, I want to drink something out there. I don't want to drink what I can get here out there.
Absolutely.
When I was in Hood River, I didn't touch our beer. All I drank was, what did I drink? I don't remember. Frame, Loxton, and Double Mountain.
Double Mountain's good.
Because it's right there.
Yep.
That's kind of the neat thing. I know Hood River pretty well. So went down to Frame, had a few beers, had some food, really nice right there on the waterfront, and went up a little bit to Loxton. And wasn't really quite sure where the other one was until I turned my head, and there it was right out the window. So they're all really close together on 4th Street up there. But you get a chance. That's one thing the Shutesbury does as well, as we celebrate not only ourselves and the beer that we make, but the culture of beer overall, everybody. We recommend you go see everyone else in town, too. There's 32 breweries.
Wow.
In Bend alone.
I didn't know
that
many.
32.
Yeah.
Some are quite small. Some are like us. Some are like Cascade Lake. Some are like Ten Barrel. Some are like Good Luck. It kind of just depends.
We just went to Boneyard.
Boneyard is fantastic. Boneyard is going to stay Boneyard. They're going to do what they do, and that's fine. Every part they have in that facility is from another brewery. Used equipment. Boneyard Brewery, RPM, really nice beer. They do it a good job. But yeah, go see everyone else too. Let's get back to us though.
You bet.
Absolutely.
All right. 1,300 beer barrel capacity fermentation vessels. We create beer barrels, which are 31 gallons US, or basically 2 50-liter kegs per brewery. These are the largest we have. They are fermentation vessels, so we don't fill them up, because if you fill them up and then pitch in the yeast, they blow up, potentially. Too much pressure, no work for it to go. So about 900 or 1,000 barrels, pitch in the yeast, let it do its thing, start creating alcohol content. Then we kind of go from there. But these are by far the largest, 10 of them we have up there. 5 arrived when we did the expansion of the lobby, as well as the expansion of the taste room, and built this nice Cellar 3 in 2012. These 5 down this end arrived in 2013. Guess when they were supposed to arrive?
2017.
This year, actually.
Oh, really?
2016. Initially, it was 2016 when we were supposed to have them in, but we got a little ahead of ourselves. That was a 16% growth year. Hard to say you're having fun when you're ripping your hair out and trying to figure out what's what, but it was a neat way to see what we can actually accomplish. In about 5 years, we'll be in another facility on the East Coast. I don't know if you've heard about that.
Yeah, I heard about that.
I don't know where it's at yet. I don't think we've announced yet. I know the 2 spots that they are contemplating, but unless you guys listen directly, I cannot tell you. But we are hopeful that will be announced in the next month or so.
Maintaining your complete independence.
That's the idea. Yep. That is the idea. You know, kind of like what they're doing. Who else is out there? Sierra Nevada, New Belgium. More on the lines of the Sierra Nevada plan, because they went into it looking at it like, well, gee, we're a big company. We can help the smaller breweries, especially the Asheville Brewers Association, get their ingredients less expensively for a while, and let them kind of ride the coattails for a minute, which I thought was kind of a neat thing. Great stewards for craft beer.
Yeah, absolutely.
New Belgium's kind of doing the same thing with their property, although they're not open yet because they got a piece of property, from what I understand, that was almost given to them by the city because it was terrible, with the agreement that they would build an abutment on the river that would be a bike path from them to where Sierra Nevada is and wherever another brewery might be on the other side of it. So that would be quite fascinating. That is one of the spots that we're looking at, is Asheville. So that would be quite fascinating to see what happens. But, you know, overall, it'll be a good thing. It'll probably keep us where we're at because everyone else is moving out there, too, and opening second facilities. But as far as where we rank, as far as independent craft goes, Northwest, we're number one. As far as what we sell, as far as independent craft beers. U.S. currently, I haven't got the list for 2015 or 2016's list, but I imagine we'll move up. But we were number 7 last year and number 12 overall. You got Lagunitas coming off, you got Founders coming off because of their purchases by Constellation and by Heineken. But we should move up to 5 or 6, or maybe stay at 7. We don't know. Well, we don't know what else is going on around us right now. It's an exciting time to be in this business.
Yeah.
It's great. Competition is us. I get asked a lot of times, well, what's competition? Competition for us is us.
Right, absolutely.
We're not competing with anybody else. Ten Barrel's not competing with us.
No.
They shouldn't be. They should be competing with their own beer.
Yeah.
We're competing to make our next beer as good as it can be and fully involving you guys in the process. Whether you know it or not, you're being used.
That's fine.
Nobody right. seems to care.
Use me some more.
You live here in town?
I live in outside of Portland.
So you've been to the pub up there, probably the pub
here? Yeah.
Have you been to the pub yet?
No.
The pub here is the original brewery. The Schutz Brewing Public House downtown on Bond Street is the original brewery. It opened up in 1988, June 27th. Gary, his wife, moved over here with their little ones, wanted to run a business, and wanted to raise her children and play golf. And Ben had 18,000 people 27 and a half years ago, 82,000 now, so slightly different.
Yeah.
The pub took off. It wasn't like the idea for Deschutes Brewery at the time was to build a massive facility like this and start shipping beer all over the country. It was to run a pub and, you know, just kind of have a good life and raise your children. It evolved. The beer spoke, we listened, and another facility was eventually needed, which we're going to walk into for a moment, in just a moment. Bend at the time was a timber town, the big time timber town. Brooks Scanlon mill down there was an REI. It was a lot of wood. The river was full of logs. Now it's a beer town with an outdoor recreation problem. There's Central Oregon in a nutshell for you right there. You got to have the workout so you can work off all the beer. 32 breweries, everyone, in Bend.
Right.
40 total, if you count Redmond, Prineville, Sisters, and those kind of places. There's an awful lot of beer out there, a good beer, too. That's why we say celebrate the culture. You guys ready to go inside?
Yep,
absolutely. All right, come on in. This is J.D. Brew House. It was completed in 1993 when the pub and a 12.5 barrel system wasn't going to be big enough for where we were headed. City didn't like the idea of too many deliveries and trucks and everything blocking the streets. So we basically need another location in which to brew, so this was born. This building is called Brew 2. The whole building is Brew 2. Portland is Brew 3. The new facility will be Brew 4. So Portland Bend Pub is Brew 1, or as we call it, the pub. But that's where it all started. All
right, here we go. You ready to go? All right, that was it. Get a big whiff.
Yeah. All right. There you go. So come up the green line here, guys. That's about 16 to 20 varieties generally we have in here.
These are about 200-pound bags that you're looking at.
That's awesome.
Yep. Wow.
It's a good smell.
It is a good smell. And when they say we get them, when they're growing, they're very wet, very cone-like. This is what we get them like. These are pressed and dried, so we can keep them fresh all year long. You can actually keep them fresh for years if you want to. We have some older ones up top. It's kind of neat to see what kind of flavors develop over the time period. And they might sit up there, the isovaleric flavors, those kind of things. If you're looking for that, but this is how we receive them, press and dry, so we keep them fresh all the time. If you want to taste one, grab one. Everybody take a hop.
Go ahead.
Take a hop and then rip that puppy open. Get down by the base of the stem, you'll see what we're after when we boil. Now, the yellow powder at the base of the stem, that is what we are after when we boil. That is called lupulin. That is the dried hop oil. When they're growing, they're very liquid. This is still very wet. If you want to taste what this would be like, say this is your first hop going into your beer. Okay? What? That's going to give you your bitterness. First hop.
Yep.
Wet your finger, dip it on there, put it right on the tip of your tongue. And you should get that initial bitterness as if this is the first hop going into your beer. Okay, now let's sit there for a moment. And then as you do when you drink beer, because you're no longer breathing through your throat, you're swallowing beer. So, in through the nose, and it should start to mimic that behavior of that beer moving backwards in your head.
Right.
The bitterness kind of dissipates a tad bit, and it starts to thicken up and grab the side of your tongue, soft palate gets in, and then up the nose, down the throat with the florals and the citruses.
Yeah.
One hot flower is capable of doing that to your head. We use 55-gallon buckets of these things. Anybody want 55 gallons? I can administer slowly. It's pretty fun. I'm a sadist, so I enjoy the heck out of it. All right. Well, if you want to keep your hop, do otherwise toss it there in the gray bucket. Inside those tanks are 8 feet up and 8 feet down from what you're seeing. Over here, the ladder tent is only 3 feet under the floor, the number two down there. The others are between 8 and 18 feet under the surface. So, guys, this is sensory tasting. This is sensory chemistry and microbiology. The whole hallway is dedicated to making sure you guys get quality and consistency in all of your beers, and that's what it's about. Without one or the other, you're done. There's too many choices, 32 breweries in this town alone with 10 to 20 beers apiece. That's a lot of beer, and it's good beer. So you got to be on your game. So we test constantly throughout the process to make sure the beer is where it's supposed to be today. Over here, we're checking for alcohol by volume. We're making sure international bittering is looking good, making sure pH is nice and balanced throughout the process, no deviations there, and also fermentation. What's happening out there is alcohol level rising appropriately within those tanks, the RDF, a real degree of fermentation. What happens to blends? Because we're blending batches together in these tanks. We're not doing 21,400 gallons at once. There's a bunch of those tanks. There's a whole bunch of fermentation vessels. At one point, we had 39.1 and 11 of others, and we've got more now, so I have to get the new numbers because I've been gone for 9 days. I know 10 more are coming in the back, the same size as the ones we have in front. So we're just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Maximum capacity here will be about 670,000 barrels by the time we're done with this round of expansion. So pretty exciting times. Gas chromatograph is utilized in our lab to ionize the liquid. We then look at that through a spectrum analyzer and see what it looks like by chemical component, the spike, chemical compound, day to day to day to day, all the way through the process. Quality and consistency. This room here, we taste it too. Every single batch. Love that Evel Knievel suit, man. That was awesome.
I'm going to wear it in your house, my man.
You should. This is sensory tasting. Only employees do this. We don't outsource this to anybody but us. This is only employees. 32 people on sensory panel. 500 employees close to that work for Deschutes Brewery. Right. So it's a pretty exclusive club. It takes a while to make. Could be looking up upwards of a year. Straight palate training. Recognition of our beers. But what do you think we want you to do first? First thing we want you to recognize in our beer. When you get a beer handed to you, what do you think the first thing we want you to recognize is?
Either the color or the smell.
Go with the first one.
The color.
Eyes lead to the nose. Nose leads to the mouth. That's what sensory is about. This is 65%+ of your experience, your nose. Aroma has got to be tantalizing to make your wrist do one of two things. Lift it or push it aside or put it back down. So the best tasting beer in the world could have the worst, most off-putting aroma, and most people aren't going to drink it. Some people don't pick up aroma as well as others, so they won't have the opportunity to drink it. Wow, that's one of the best beers I've ever had. Too bad you can't drink it because it smells terrible. But it's all personal perception and personal preferences and things like that. So we learn the beers. We learn the attributes in the beers, the citruses, the florals, the chocolates. It depends on the beers that we're drinking. We learn the attributes within the attributes, and then that lovely list on the wall behind you. Yeah. This is the beer descriptor list of what can happen to it. If you mistreat it yourself, skunky, or if it's brewed incorrectly, too hot, too cold, too long, too short, floral, hoppy, warming, good carbonation, good alcohol levels, rancid, moldy. There's some pretty nasty things on there, and you have to be able to recognize the flavors.
I am
a member of the sensory panel, so I do taste a lot of these flavors. They train us with these. There are tablets out there. There are vials of these smells. We put them in the beers. We learn what they taste like, because we need to know what they taste like in a 4-ounce glass versus a 21,400-gallon tank. So some of these are definitely unpleasant, but they're meant to be. It helps us make sure you guys get the best beer you can get. So I am on the sensory panel. I'm one of the 32. So we come here 5 days a week. Got the new iPads in there. We just kind of go with what the beer looks like first by using that light. And make sure it looks bright, hazy, opaque, cloudy. There's stuff floating in it. We mark that down as well. The screen will then pop up with our sliding scale for the beers that we drink, 0 to 15. And we just mark up what we think it lands, each individual attribute, based on our own personal preferences. And scale numbers we talk about for the attributes within the beer all the time. But it's also mostly based on what I taste, because I taste different than you, and you taste different than her, and you taste different than him. Everybody's tastes are different. So it's a percentage-based thing to a point. When we're done with that batch, or that taste, water, crackers, cleanse the palate, do another one. And here, as few as 4, as many as 20. Kind of depends on the time of year and the season and what we're pushing out the door. And then we go back and do our regular gig when we're done. It takes maybe 10 or 15 minutes, if that. But it's a nice thing to be able to say you're one of the last people to taste before it leaves the building.
Right, absolutely.
We're the last line of defense for the beer before it exits on the trucks. Fermentation vessels, conditioning tanks. See the pipe on the top of the FVs? That's how we vent the gas. The gas will rise in the tank, the CO2. Comes down that pipe with the hose and in the pipe, either hook it up to one of the pumps there or we hook it up and drop it in a bucket of water. Essentially, then the gas escapes from the water but acting as a seal, a hydro lock going the other direction. Heat is regulated by use of double jackets. Coils on the inside, 404A cool glycol and freon systems, pulling heat out, pushing cool back in. Maintains the temperature for our English ale yeast at 63 degrees. Which is optimal for our yeast strain to do what it needs to do. We eventually drop temperature down to 34, excuse me guys, to deactivate that yeast. Pumps together, falls to the bottom, it's easy to remove. We test it, still good, we use it again. As I mentioned, about 10 to 12 generations out of the English ale yeast. Once it's no longer vital for brewing and agrocycle, we'll turn the stuff into fertilizer. So good. Do one of these now to clean it up. Our filtering system, we operate 2 centrifuges. That's a small particle, 4,000 to 4,200 RPM, about 50 to 70 gallons at a time. Make it look like we want it to look. Nice and bright, a little bit hazy, like, say, chain brick. Just 2 inches left, forced carbonation. Comes out of the bright, the fermentation vessel's about 2 to 3% naturally. We bumped it up to about 10. And it brights for about a day to a week or so. Day-ish, depending upon what we're doing, up to 8 days. Mellows out, matures, enhances, participates, does its beer thing in there. The brewers, excuse me, they will be looking at it, smelling it, tasting it, make sure it's where it's supposed to be as along its way. Labs tested it, we're tasting it in sensory. As I mentioned down there, once the sensory panel says go, in the package it will be within 2 days, generally. And then it's off to you guys to drink up. So do so. Drink and enjoy. That'd be silly. So this is kind of where we came in, guys. This is the JV tanks right here. This is the beginning of the forest, the tanks heading down to the bottom of the line itself. We have tanks ranging from 100s, 200s, 400s, 960s, up to 1300s out in front. So quite a few tanks of varying sizes to do different things, fermentation vessels and conditioning vessels both. This is our CIP grid over there as well for cleaning, moving caustic and acidic materials around the building without getting it into any of the tanks. I'm going here if anybody wants to look. Not feeling messy, but at least gives you an indication that just how much pressure will be building up inside that vessel. Yes, yeast and a little bit of beer eventually. This is our bottling line. Directly beneath us, this is a Krohn's machine. We have our rinser, filler, and the tall machine over there is the cranner that applies caps to the bottles themselves. The glass we use comes out of Owens, Illinois facility up near PDX in Portland. The bottles we get are up to 80% recycled material. Very proud of that. And 4,000 pieces per pallet. They're being palletized in the next room, eventually making their way this way. The lower rater over there will take them down to the main floor. You can kind of see them coming this direction. They'll eventually hit the rinser, and they'll be inverted. We turn them upside down so we can blow high pressure hot water inside to clean them out. Get out whatever was in the bottle from the strip over from the valve. They're sterile when we get them, but we want to make sure there's nothing in the bottle. If the glass is weak, we also want the break in the facility. Break on the rinser, break on the filler, either one. Break in the middle of a pallet, ruins the entire pallet of beer. Plus it's embarrassing. Don't really want that to happen. So, blow it up here, or maybe the next one will get it to move. 84 head filler. Clamp onto the top of the bottle after you fill it with CO2 because otherwise there's nothing but pressure more than that glass. Fill it with CO2, clamp on the top of the bottle and pull up the bottom up, pushing the CO2 out with excess air and foam at the same time. Nice and lovely clean beer and crown, like everything dissipates. Tall machine then gets it next. Tall machine is our crown. What that will do is slap the crown on, and as it exits, we rinse them off because they're covered in beer, they're covered in sugar. Want all that off, and they make their way through. Believe it or not as well, this entire line used to fit on that side of the catwalk a year ago. So now we gotta move so I can show you the rest of it. Used to be able to just stand in one spot.
Okay, get the burn, knock them all off. Okay, good.
Woo! Glass exploding, it's, you know, part of the process. Put too much pressure in the glass. Found out when they all work. Also where we house the artwork. This adorns our Jubilee packaging since 1995. Going back to 1988, if you'd walked to the pub with me in October that year, you'd have seen three beers on tap. Cascade Golden Ale, we don't make that anymore. Bachelor Bitter, which we poured at the pub, so you can get it there still, and then Blackbeet Porter. Fourth recipe for Deschutes Brewery, Jubilee Ale. First bottled beer for Deschutes Brewery was Jubilee Ale, out of the taps at the pub in the 1950s. Capped, foiled, labeled, sold out of the pub as our holiday seasonal.
How did the name come about?
Jubilation.
No, Deschutes.
Deschutes is the name of the county, and Deschutes is French for River of Falls. But Deschutes is just the name of the county, so Deschutesbury just made sense. That'd be my guess. That's where we are, and Gary was here. I'd ask him real quick. But more than likely, just there was no Deschutes. There was no breweries. Period. So it made perfect sense at the time, I'm sure. But
so
this.
Do you have a single person who does your artwork?
We do not. This one changes yearly. What we do with this one to make it stand out, because we wanted to differentiate it once it started really heading further away, distribution-wise, from not only the other breweries' winter beers, but our own core brands. So we use a regional artist, put out a bone, so to speak. They call, bring in your stuff, portfolios, bodies of work,
right,
internet sites, that kind of stuff. We look them over with a panel of judges, looking for style, looking for something we think is going to, like as all these do, work out into representation of Central Oregon winter. So once the artist is chosen by the panel, the Deschutes Brewery then commissions the artist, and they create what you see on the wall here, brand spanking new, based on what we've seen. And it's really a unique way to present it, because it not only, it doubles the anticipation for the beer. The artists are all local, all but two of them, and those two are from Portland and Vancouver, respectively. The other ones are all out of Central Oregon, so people know the artists. It's different artists every year to this point, and as I said, this is the only label the Deschutes Brewery creates that changes yearly. and now since 1995. Year was on the bottles underneath each of the original pieces, as well as the name of the artist. So take a look around, and then we're heading back downstairs. Quench your thirst.
Nice.
Sometimes the previous year's artist may be part of the judging panel the next year, too. I think they are eligible if they'd like to try again to do so, but we also like to give as many people an opportunity as possible.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah, they're all really cool. A lot of herbs.
Yeah, that was one of my favorite Chubaloyo.
That's Christmas tree, I think. Yeah. This one's unique as it's containing elements of all of them up to that point.
Yeah.
Casey asked for a box of old labels and cut into pieces.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. Like
300 hours it took her to finish that.
This one is good too.
That is. It's a class.
Very cool. Well, it's great that they use the individual artists instead of something unique.
Yeah.
They create something for us.
Yeah. It makes it more, you know, local because they're local artists.
Yeah.
And what a great thing to throw in your portfolio.
Sure.
I don't know, Abbott here got quite a bit, so he drew that with pens, by the way.
There's two signs, one goes to the left and one goes to the right. Pick one.
All roads lead to beer. Okay. Thanks for coming, guys. Right, thanks
thank
for
you.
Sure it's a big
great
tour.
Thank you.
Much
thank you.
I appreciate that. Much appreciated, guys. Well, it's my pleasure.
Yeah,
thank
really
you.
Nice meet you.
You as well.
So that was our tour of Deschutes Brewery, and we had a great time. We stopped here at a really good viewpoint for seeing mountains over here by Sisters, so we have a little wind noise and we apologize. But what was the one thing you wanted to bring up about going to the tour?
So the tour, it doesn't cost anything, but you do have to register or make sure you're there at a time when they do the tours. And part of the tour package is they give you four samples that you can choose from, and they've got lots of different types to choose from. So Rob chose his and I chose mine, and we each tested each other's and stuff, and it was really good. It was definitely a little hard to film in there, but definitely worthwhile to stop in and go through that.
Yeah, we had a little trouble with our gimbal, so I had to hold the camera manually. So if it's a little shaky or in the middle of that tour, it actually died, and so I got some really funny shots, so I apologize for that, but hey, that's the chance you take when you do that stuff. So anyway, thank you for watching. I'm Rob.
I'm Sherry.
And we'll talk to you later. Bye.
Bye.
Hey, thanks for watching our video. Don't forget to discover our other YouTube playlist, RV Travel Buddy, which is tips, resources, and services, RV Travel Quest, where you can follow Rob and Sherry on their real RV travel experiences, RV Living Mission Series, which teaches people how to prepare to be an RVer in the future, the insane RV 360 videos, our amazing RV.TV, where amazing stories come from RVers, and last but not least, RV Talk Radio. And most of all, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks again.